Okay, you guys ready to start? Okay? Good. So when we're talking about positioning, and we're going to watch some tapes here in just a little bit too, but we are virtually talking about, you know, body alignment. When we have to keep the resident, and this is chapter 11, we have to keep the resident in good alignment through the use of pillows, through the use of different help devices, keeping their back straight, keeping their arms propped, because a lot of times if we don't have that body alignment, we can actually be hurting the resident more than helping them. That's why when we turn them, we've got to make sure that they're not laying on their arm. Because of course, you know, you could imagine laying on your arm for 2 hours. With them, with the muscle deterioration, atrophy in the shoulder, we could literally pop it out. We could dislocate their shoulder. So, you know, body alignment is extremely important. Changing position is extremely important. Like, none of you are going to sit for the next 2 hours in the exact position that you're in right now. Most of you are going to shift your weight from one hip to the other. You may stretch, you may move, you're going to do something. Well, that's because you've got the muscles to do it. And the reason why you're shifting your weight is because your body knows that if you've been sitting on your left side for a long time, well, the blood flow to that area is down. You've got to get blood flow to that area, so you're just going to switch over to your other side. The elderly simply can't do that. Where we put them so many times is where they stay. So changing position is vitally important. Draw sheet, of course, we talked about that the other day. That is our tool that we help turn them in bed. Just grabbing them like we used to do, behind the shoulder, behind the hip, and pulling them over, creates skin tears and creates bruises as our fingers can actually dig into them. And of course, if our fingernails are a little bit longer than they should be, scratching and basically skin tears. So the draw sheet we're going to be, you know, practicing and using today, but it's basically just a little sheet underneath them that we grab the sheet and turn them over. It's a lot easier. Gait belt, we were using that the other day, and of course what that is for is that handle to take a hold of the people to move them safely. When you guys were transferring me the other day, there is no way that most of you could have done it without a gait belt. If you were just to take me underneath the shoulders and try to lift me that way, you know, just underneath the armpits, probably most of you would not have been able to get me up out of the chair, would not have been able to transfer me. It was a gait belt that gave you the leverage to basically be able to move my heavy weight. And it's the same way with your residents. You need that leverage to basically get a hold of them. Mechanical lift, of course, we're going to see some on the tapes here, some used. It's a great device. One of the people pointed out yesterday that one of the local nursing homes have gone to what they called a no-lift facility. Now, we hadn't been there in several months, so I knew that they were going that way, but I didn't know that they had. So what that means is this. If you go into George's room and you can move George by yourself, just one staff member, one nurse, move George, transfer him by yourself, that's okay. But if it takes two of you, no. Like when you did the double lift on me the other day, that's out of this facility. You go get the mechanical lift. Now, they bought, I guess, several more, so they've got several down each hall. But it's really a neat device. Now, there's two different lifts. One is just called the stand-up. It's where the person's sitting on the chair, sitting on the bed, and they put like a gait belt around them. It's wider than a gait belt, though. And then it's hooked onto these hooks. They take a hold of the handlebars, and it's like they're riding a big old motorcycle with big old, you know, handlebars way up here. You know, and the machine just stands them up from the sitting position, just stands them up. Now the other is basically a mechanical lift. It's more like a sling where you have like a canvas draw sheet that you lay underneath them from their shoulders down to their knees, and it just lifts them up like a sling, and they're just in this sling. So evidently, this is what this nursing home has gone to. Most nursing homes, when they do this, the reason why they do this is because there have been too many staff members that have hurt their backs. At the nursing home that I know of, there were like 8 staff members in 1 year that hurt their backs lifting on the residents. And so basically, they went to this policy. No lift. They bought several newer, a lot. They bought like 4 or 5 extra of these mechanical lifts. So we had a couple down each hall. And actually it saved us money. In workman's compensation, you know, a back injury, you know, was on the average was costing about $20,000 per staff member. And so it was well worth it to buy these lifts because the back injuries from the staff just dropped dramatically. Positioning, here again, just like I said, the resident is going to depend upon you guys to change their position in bed, in the chair. So it's important when we put them in the chair that they're in, like the wheelchair, for instance, or in the bed or wherever we put them, that they do have this proper, this good body alignment. When they're in the wheelchair, their back, their bottom is back to the back of the chair, their arms are supported, they're not just hanging or dangling down, but they're supported, because it has happened. People get their fingernails in the spokes of these wheelchairs, and here comes a staff member to bring them to lunch. They don't talk before they touch. They just grab the wheelchair and start moving them and clip off a couple of fingers because they get caught in the spokes. So when we position them in the chair, you know, we want to have them sitting up straight, not leaning to one side or the other. If they are, we put something in there to prop them up. We don't want their arms dangling down because, you know, well, just to do this, I mean, if any of us was to let our arms dangle down for about an hour, you know, pretty soon, in a few minutes, you're going to start to feel tingling in your fingertips. And then you will feel the weight of your arm pulling on your shoulder just simply by the weight of your arm hanging down. Well, our shoulders are still pretty healthy, pretty strong. But a lot of our elderly are not, and this type of a hanging down will pull the shoulder, will dislocate it out. It's just like when they're in bed. If they're laying on their side, this top arm needs to be on a pillow. Because if it's just laying in front of them or laying back behind them like that, the same thing will basically happen. The pulling action could dislocate their shoulder. So positioning, correct positioning for the residents is just vitally important. Shearing, we talked about, that's that friction when we pull people up in bed. We're supposed to use the draw sheet and lift them up and then bring them up in bed. But if we just grab them and pull them, basically, that creates that friction, that creates that shearing, that tearing, and eventually it'll wear down the skin until finally it gets so thin because of the friction, it'll tear all apart. So shearing is something we have to watch out for. Now, I understand that there is a new sheet coming out, and it's virtually made out of what the same material that parachutes are made out of. And that sheet is supposed to have, this is what they're claiming right now, zero shearing. So, you know, that's going to be wonderful, you know, because a lot of residents do get drug up, you know, and do have shearing problems. Transfer belt, of course, where I talked about. So, when it comes, you know, like somebody said, what's the first thing you do is you assess the load, you think ahead, you plan, check your base of support, face whatever you're lifting, keep your back straight, bend squatting, tighten stomach muscles. Keep the object as close to you as you can. You know, the resident, of course. So that's why, like we talked about, you're breaking through those three space bubbles, bang, bang, bang. Talk before you touch. You're going to get extremely close to them. So talk to them. Tell them what you're going to do. And then be careful that you don't twist your body. Lift up your feet and pivot. Just don't twist at your waist. Because here again, our muscles in our back are like spaghetti. They're not bulky muscles like your arms and legs, and they will stretch, they will hurt. There will be days when you may be leaving going, oh, my aching back, you know. Squatting, it shows you a good picture on 170 here about keeping your back straight. We've talked about these positions on 171 already, and I virtually just wanted to go through those definitions again. Because a lot of this stuff here we're going to see on the tapes and stuff.
Does this part on the, it's on the test too, Wednesday,
uh-huh,
too, right?
Yeah, the test for the next time.
No, I meant for this one that's coming up on Thursday?
Yeah. It's chapters, what, 6, 11?
3 and 4.
3, 4? 3, 4, 6, 11, yeah. So that's why I kind of wanted to review some of these words. So you can look through here and see these pictures. And like I said, when you're reading, when it gives you steps, you know, review those steps. Anything it gives you, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever, review those things. Anything that it says guidelines in this chapter or any chapter, read and become familiar with those guidelines. Okay, chapter 10 is actually where we start for today. Okay, bed making, unit care. The bed is where the resident will virtually spend, what, up to 50% of their time, maybe even more. So it's important that it's clean, it's dry, it's wrinkle free. Because if it gets wet, moisture harbors bacteria. If the bed gets wet and their skin is against it, it will start to damage the skin. Urine, like I said, and BM have chemicals in them that will, if left on the skin, burn the skin. So we have, that's why we got to wash off the resident, okay? But if it's left on the linens and the linens aren't changed, well, the wet linen's gonna be against the resident and really that will damage the skin. Sometimes, and I just said this to my wife last night, we were talking about an oil leak in our car. It was antifreeze. How did it get way back here to the back of the engine? And I said, Denise, how many times have you wondered in the nursing home when you went in to change a resident and the urine was literally halfway up their back and they were in bed with the head of the bed up? Now, explain that, you know? So, and I was trying to explain about the antifreeze leak, but how it will, you will see that. So that's why when you clean off the residence, sometimes just cleaning up the peri area is not enough. between their legs, front and back. We have to go maybe halfway up their abdomen, down their thighs, halfway their knees, front and back, and then maybe wash halfway up their back, because you will see that the urine, it like migrates, it wicks or something in the linens and it draws it, and it'll be wet halfway up their back with their head of their bed still up. So bed making, you know, is a comfort measure. It's just like when you turn to residents, flip the pillow over. You know, they've been laying on this side for like 2 hours, because mostly we turn people every 2 hours on the average. Now, yeah, there will be some people that we turn more frequently, but for the most part, it's every 2 hours. Well, they've been on the side of that pillow for 2 hours. They've been sweating, it's hot, it may be even a little bit smelly. Flip it over, give them the cool side. It's a simple little thing that you can do that's just kind of refreshing. Okay. Some of your terms, anxiety, biorhythms. Biorhythms are interesting. We have a time clock within us, and we're learning more and more about all time. Like, your car never turns off. You probably know that. If you've got a clock in your car, well, you go out, for lunch in a little bit here and turn your car on, your clock has the right time on it. Why? Because it still had a power source. Your car never turns off. And of course, our bodies never turn off, because we don't stop breathing when we sleep. I mean, totally, you know. Our heart don't stop. Our brain don't stop. You know, kidneys still keep working. Everything still keeps working. And we literally have a time clock within us. Here's an example. Has this ever happened to you? This Saturday, say you're going to go someplace that is really neat. You're really excited. You're looking forward to going there. And you set your alarm clock for 6:30. Well, you wake up at 6:20. Before your alarm clock went off, a few minutes before, and a lot of times, did that ever happen to anybody in here? Yeah. How did you know it was time to get up? You went to bed, you looked at the clock, your body never totally sleeps, and the internal time clock within you woke you up. So we have rhythms in our bodies, and of course sleep is one of the biggest rhythms. Now there are basically stages to sleep, and one of the things that happens in the hospital and the nursing home is that these stages get disrupted. Now, have you ever gone like to bed, say at 9, well, we better use military time. You've gone to bed, let's say at 2100, which is 9 p.m. At about 3 o'clock in the morning, you woke up, you know, you've been sleeping 6 hours. You woke up, you went to the bathroom, went right back to bed, and you slept 3 more hours to 6. Okay, and that's when you got up for the day. Now, has this ever happened to you? When you got up at 6 o'clock, you thought, I was more awake at 3 o'clock when I got up. The reason why that happened is this. We have stages of sleep. An entire stage of sleep is about 6 hours. Now, if we get interrupted with our stage of sleep, like say here's 9, 10, 11, and right here is like midnight, and here's 1 and 2. We go to bed, and let's just say the dog or somebody wakes us up barking at 11 o'clock, and we wake up. We do not just continue on. We go back to the very beginning again and start these steps all over again. So what happened here at 3 o'clock? You completed a whole sleep cycle from 9 to 6. Some people are 5 hours, some people are 5 and a half, some are 6, some are 7. You know, different people have different lengths. But in this scenario, you completed a whole sleep cycle, so when you went back to bed again, you woke up halfway through it. You didn't get a complete sleep cycle, and that's why, because of not the complete one, you were actually more tired at 6 o'clock than you were at 3 o'clock. So what happens to our residents is we are constantly, you know, we put them to bed about 8 o'clock, we go in at 10 o'clock, we wake them up, they go back to here again. We go in at midnight, they don't continue on, but they go back, start all over again. 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock, the same thing keeps happening. They are never completing a whole sleep cycle because we are constantly waking them up. And when we do, we send them back, kind of like a board game. If you cheat, like, is it Monopoly? Go to jail, start all over again, whatever it's called. We're constantly sending them back here. So what we've got to do is find ways, because we have to turn them. We need to go in and clean them. We need to check them, see if they're incontinent of bowel and bladder. We've got to find ways, basically, that we can do this without waking them fully up. Like, a lot of times, simply, it might just be like, say we have two guys in a room, George and Bill. Bill's incontinent, we gotta go in and check him every 2 hours, but George isn't. Well, down the hallway is Pete and Clyde, and they have the same scenario down there. One of them is not incontinent, don't need to be checked, but the other is. Well, what we can simply do is change some rooms around. Get the two together that need to be checked and the two together that don't have to be, so at least those two can get sleep. There are ways that we can go in and change people and not fully wake them up. Like, maybe don't flip on all the lights. Be as quiet as we can when we go in. Use as little lights as possible. Our wipes are really cold, and of course, cold against the skin is going to wake you up. Maybe we need to warm them up a little bit. So there are things that we've got to start doing so that we don't, because maybe if we don't fully wake them up, we won't send them back to the beginning. But if we wake them up barely to get them turned and everything, we do it gently and quietly, maybe they will be able to keep on going. Because when sleep deprivation comes in, it causes confusion. You may have felt it. If you've ever been awake for a really, really long time, you know, you may have started to feel like after 8